Welcome to the Hold the Line podcast. Sean Foyt here, and today we are so blessed and honored to get one of my best friends in the world, Jay Koopman, who's with us. We're down here in Southern California in Orange County, and you may recognize Jay, or you may recognize his voice as the crazy guy in the Let Us Worship videos, giving the most insane altar calls you've ever heard in your whole life. And we've been doing it in 138 cities across America. And I get asked frequently about Jay and his background and his story and what makes him so intense. And so I thought it'd be amazing to have him on and to share not only what God has been doing, but what we are sensing for Let Us Worship and Hold the Line in the coming season. So Jay.
Hey, man. Man, I think this year, Sean, was something that, I mean, who would ever dream that we would see thousands of people gather three or four times a week across America, yeah. 138 cities, and to see not just crazy salvation, see people yeah. receive the presence of the Lord, hope and boldness and courage, but at the same time, drug addicts throwing their drugs on the stage, suicide being broken, and even people dealing with identity issues completely being not just bold about it, but getting healed and confessing weeks later, hey, I'm set free of those ideas, man. I'm set free of that mindset. So what a crazy year. I'm still pinching myself going, I can't believe that just happened.
Yeah, totally. And, you know, I think the amount of, I don't know, it's hard. People try to classify what's happening with Let Us Worship because it's hard to put it into a box, yeah. you know? Like first it started as a petition, actually, you know, it was a petition to stand against the tyrannical governor Gavin Newsom and his really hypocritical and his attacks of bigotry against the church, discriminatory, all those kind of things. And so it started as a petition, Let Us Worship, getting pastors and leaders to sign on this petition that we're going to stand up. Then it moved into the place where, oh, we should actually do something. So we gathered on the Golden Gate Bridge last July, and here we are. And so I thought it'd be cool to start out by you sharing a little bit of your background because, you know, there's something that happens in seasons of crisis like the pandemic where it's like courage becomes contagious, yeah. you know, and it's like the bold find each other, like we have to survive. And so, you know, I never forget when we were driving down to Pasadena and I reached out to you and I'm like, we got to do something in LA. We got to do, and you're like, when? And I'm like, next week, you know, and you like, you went for it. You know, you mobilized. We got letters, you know, saying they were going to throw us in jail if we met on the street corner. And, you know, it's hard to find somebody that's like willing to like yeah. go there with you and not care. And Jay was one of those. So why don't you share a little bit about how we connected, but also a little bit of your history, where you came from, and how that has prepared you
right.
for the season we're in.
Well, you know, we right when you were running for Congress, we had mutual friends, and so we hung out and talked a little bit about your campaign before the pandemic. But right when you know the churches were shut down, you know, thank God my pastor decided to open and to sue Governor Newsom, but. You know, for me, it was like...
I sued and won.
We won in the Supreme Court. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody.
I think it was the fourth or fifth time now that the Supreme Court has overruled the governor of California.
Yeah.
Which is mind-boggling, but go ahead.
Yeah, so all of a sudden, when he sues Governor Newsom, all of the friends that are our age, I don't want to say all, but a lot of them that are our age and younger, half of them agreed with it and the other half didn't. And I'm thinking, I'm an ex-drug addict. I'm someone who, yeah. the only reason why I'm alive today and not in prison, married with a beautiful wife, two beautiful children, and also now I have a new life in Jesus as a pastor is because Jesus can push back the darkness.
Right.
So I'm listening to all these guys preach for years about revival and yeah. healing the sick and yeah. Casting out demons. And now this plague has hit the world and all these pastors are shutting down and complying. And right. so I felt like I was looking at Pastor Che going, what are we going to do? When are we going to do something? And thank God he was bold. But then all of a sudden I saw And we had each other's phone number because we hung out before. I saw what you did in New York like the very first week, and I saw what you did in Orange County. And that's when we texted each other, and I was like, hey, this is a move of God. Right. And I was just looking for a friend my age that believed what I believed.
Right.
Somebody that could lead the way. And so I remember, you know, you said, hey, let's do this next week. And I was like, let's go. And all of a sudden, all hell breaks loose. Like, I mean, you talk about letters coming to me and my church saying we're going to go to jail. Now, you and I are getting letters saying that if we do this event, we're going to go to jail. And I remember that day because you were driving from Northern California, and it was a hard day for you guys, you and your family. Yeah. And we just kind of locked in like Jonathan and David that day. And we had never actually done ministry together, even though we'd hung out. And it was just like two lions with different gift mix that could just come together. And I remember the power of God hitting that street. And it didn't matter how many letters I got, how many letters you got, how much pushback we got from our friends, we saw this outpouring on this street corner in Los Angeles. And after that, man, it was all she wrote. Yeah. And so I thank God for you and your family because you actually fully believe what I believe. And I say what I believe, meaning that I would not be a pure man of God today if it wasn't for the type of faith that you have that set me free 24 years ago. Yeah. And so I'm so grateful for you. I'm grateful for Let Us Worship. And who would have ever thought that I mean, when I signed up to help you that day, I just wanted to do something. I had no agenda. You asked me when we were standing there, you're like, hey, bro, you want to preach? And you didn't even know if I could preach well. And all of a sudden, together, man, we just saw God do amazing things. And now you're talking about over 130 something cities later, we're seeing God do, I mean, it's just full blown revival. We were prophesying revival then. We were saying it, but now we're actually seeing it. Now we're seeing people just by the droves running to the altar and all these wonderful things that are happening. And so my wife's excited, my family's excited, my church. The cool thing about my church is a lot of the young adults that did stay with us, not only did our church grow with radical boldness, but they're totally transformed.
Yeah.
You know, it's just they're transformed because of the boldness of what we did in Let Us Worship, much like other cities that we went to together. And so, I mean, I like you always say, we haven't seen anything yet.
Yeah. Well, it's wild. I think, you know, looking at the history and looking at, you know, how the Lord prepared all of us for this season that we live in. And that's the thing I try to encourage, you know, believers. I'm like, man, you have what it takes. Like you've been sitting here listening to messages and sermons and podcasts and reading books. And like, now this is the season to go, man, apply all that, you know, make it real. You know, it's like that verse, you know, that the Word became flesh and dwelt among them. Like the Word, like Jesus just wasn't an idea. He wasn't just this thought. Like he actually manifested into a human.
Right.
And he took the form of a man, you know? And in the same way, the faithfulness of God is that all of the words that we've gotten have to become flesh, you know, have to be manifested. And so the things that we've been praying for so many years, we're seeing now in front of our eyes across America. Now, we had no idea that we would have gone through the pain and the resistance and the trauma and all the other stuff. And, you know, that's real. We don't glorify that or we don't play the victim to
right.
it. But we acknowledge that, yeah, just like every significant revivalist or leader throughout history has faced pushback, we face it that much more. And we know, like Jay and I, we've rolled to enough cities where we know when we start hitting those levels, whether it be governmental, you know, resistance or Antifa or, you know, crazy BLM or whatever, we know when we start feeling that, oh, it's about to break open.
Yeah, come on.
You know, those cities, and I say this quite often, but you know, those with the greatest resistance often become the place of greatest breakthrough.
Come on, yes.
And so, and what's wild too about this anointing that we're seeing in America right now, I mean, you guys know this because you've experienced it in your communities, your churches, your homes, the level of depression, anxiety, the level of people just trying to cope right now in this season with drugs and alcohol and affairs. And I mean, people are getting divorced left and right. It's like this full-on assault, right, on families, on people. And so this is one of the reasons why we're seeing such dynamic breakthrough. We're seeing drugs thrown on the stage every city we go. I didn't do drugs growing up. I don't even know what they are. I always have to ask Jay. I'm like, what's that pipe? What are those pills? What is that? What is this stuff? I don't even know, you know? But I'm getting used to, like, leading worship, you know, normally, like, in a nice church, you know, you got your setup, you got the words, you got your pedals, you got everything. I'm used to leading worship now, like, tiptoeing around drugs. It's, like, spread all over the stage. Like, that's become kind of normal in Lettuce Worship.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen anything like that?
I've never in my life seen anything like this. I mean... You know, I remember the first time, because, you know, Let Us Worship just kind of evolved. You know, like you said, it started off as a petition and us just standing up for our religious freedom. And then I remember when we were in Texas, we gave the first altar call, and you and I both were like shocked, like, how is this going to happen with 7,000 people? People just came and ran and fell down on their knees without us even saying, asking them to.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I remember when we were in Florida and we started seeing this outpouring like never before, where people were raising their hand with like identity issues saying, I want to be free.
Right.
And so, you know, I remember when we were in Fresno, and you've always trusted me, which I really appreciate, because we've both done some crazy stuff together. We both kind of challenge each other to do wild things. But I looked at you and I said, I just said, hey, man, let me do something. And you didn't know what I was going to do. And I just called out drugs. And I got to be honest, imagine if nobody had drugs. Nobody throwing it on the stage. You know, and I just said, I feel like there's people here. And I remember this lady, she came to a worship, you know, night, or and it's hot outside. She's got a hot Bud Light. Remember, she pulled it out, a can of Bud Light, and threw it right on the stage. And all of a sudden, drugs and vapes just started coming. And you and I were tripping out. Because God did that. I mean, it's not like something, I've never even done that before.
Right.
A lot of the stuff that we're dealing with, yes, I have a background, and yes, you've been bold in the mission field, but some of the stuff we're seeing in America, it's even another level for what we've ever experienced.
Right, yeah.
So.
Well, and I think it's another level because I think that the bondage right now is so intense.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, and this is part of why I get really frustrated with this whole narrative of, you know, if you really love Jesus, you're going to put your mask on and sit in your room and watch it on the live stream, because that means you really love your neighbor. It's such a cop-out.
Yeah.
I mean, it's such a soft way to get out of stepping into places of ministry that the Lord has called you for such a time as this. I mean, imagine Esther, like Queen Esther, like in the Bible saying, oh, it's not my time. I'm going to sit in my room. Or imagine, you know, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, oh, it's not my time. We're not going to, you know, let's just bow. Or whoever. Imagine, you know, Daniel. Imagine these guys in history. They probably have a lot of good excuses, you know. And we've developed a twisted theology that allows for us to disengage from the world around us, because we feel that if we disengage, it shows people that we truly love them. I'm telling you, that is a load of crap.
Come on.
I mean, we are seeing it in cities across America. People are hurting. Yeah. People are depressed. People are killing themselves with suicide. People are overdosing. Marriages are falling apart. Homes are falling apart. Churches, you know, haven't even been open. There's some churches across America that are still not open.
Yeah.
You know, just in Tulsa, Oklahoma this week, out of all cities, there's still churches in Oklahoma that haven't opened up again.
That's right.
And, you know, and so to say that you, because of your fear and whatever, to actually pin that on the Lord and say, well, we're really loving our neighbor, that is such a load, man. And I just want to call that out right now. People have told you that and made you feel bad because you want to go to your kid's soccer game or whatever. I mean, it's levels of fear. And, you know, so they're inherently, without trying to be political, it becomes political.
Yeah.
You know, it becomes this thing where you know what? We're willing to stand up against these tyrants and these morons who are instituting these, you know, constitutional things or these unconstitutional orders that go against Judeo-biblical Bible foundations. They go against the theology of what we believe, but they also go against the U.S. Constitution.
Yeah.
And, you know, for me, I've always said this since the beginning, it's not even political, it's biblical.
That's right.
You know, what we're called to do, we have a mandate in this season to engage. I mean, can you imagine, Kate and I were talking about this on the way over here today, can you imagine if we would not have taken a stand?
Oh, my Lord.
You know, and I'm sure that the Lord, I mean, I'm sure God would have raised somebody else up and somebody else would, I have no doubt, you know. It's not that it rises and falls on us, but can you imagine how my life would have been impacted?
Oh my goodness.
You know, what my kids, they've seen the power of God. They were in CHOP.
Yeah.
Surrounded by Antifa, watching God show up. They were in the middle of Portland, Oregon while they were burning, you know, down, you know, burning the Bibles in the street and rioting like crazy. Their narrative was changed to God can invade any place at any time and bring light to the darkness. So I feel emboldened, you know, if there's anything, you know, I feel like we're called to impart, and we'll do some of that on this. It's this call to reject the soft, pansy, you call it pansy Christianity, pansy theology, that actually gives you an excuse to disengage from the world right now.
Oh my goodness. Yeah, man. I'll be honest. I, as just one person who's a pastor, who's been in ministry now for 24 years, straight out of drugs into Teen Challenge, into ministry, if they're, you know, for somebody like me, I have to take everything for real. You know what I mean? Like coming out of my past.
Yeah.
And if there wouldn't have been someone like you who made a stand in the beginning that I could say, hey, that's my friend. I want to run with him. And if I didn't know who you were, thank God I was your friend. Yeah. I would have still came. I mean, you know me, man. Like, I'm down. You want to bring revival, I'm down. But just it's just people like myself, and a lot of these people that come to these events, they're a lot like me. That's why they're coming in bondage. They're going, who's going to lead me? Who's going to help me right now? Because you're seeing people, most of them know it's a worship service, except for the people that are in the parks, like the Satanists and Antifa and all that stuff. But a lot of these people are like me. They're looking for somebody who's pure, who can lead the way. And so, man, much like your kids and much like yourself, like, I don't know what, I've had to really rewire the way that I think about certain leaders. I'm not offended with them. I'm not upset with them. But a lot of the stuff they preach, well, what happened to your message in 2020?
Yeah.
Because I believed in what you said. So thank God for people like you and other leaders. Thank God for other leaders who stood, because for somebody like me, you know, you have to mean what you say.
Right.
And I think that's why God breathed on Let Us Worship. I know that there's probably way better preachers and singers out in America.
Oh, yeah.
But God breathed on it because thousands of people were just looking for somebody who actually believes in what the Word of God says.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think that, you know, we're willing to take heat. And, you know, I've said this on multiple podcasts, but, you know, that season running in for Congress, I mean, it wasn't a waste because it really did prepare me. Now, that the resistance that I faced then pales in comparison to what we face now. Yeah. But I think it showed me, okay, like if we're gonna enter this arena, you know, we gotta be ready, man.
Yeah.
You know, we gotta come guns blazing. I wanna share a little bit about what we're gonna do in the coming season in 2022, but I really felt led to read this. And you know, keep in mind, today we're coming to you from the most restricted state in America. We just had these horrendous vaccine mandates handed down, you know, for our school children, not for people working jobs, which is huge, not for doctors and nurses, which is crazy, for children. I mean, it's like the chance of a kid dying from COVID, I want to say it's 0.0008%. Wow. And yet this is the first state that's making sure that K-12 children are taking this mandate. So, I mean, it's like Newsom is feels empowered because he's won this recall, and now he's even going crazier. So I'm speaking these words from the most restricted place that a lot of you probably listening out there have lost hope in.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you, if God can do what he's doing in this state, because there's a church, there's a remnant that is rising up. If God can do it here, he can do it anywhere. But in Isaiah 61, it has this incredible verse, and I feel like this is a big part of the mandate that we're called to in the coming season. It says, Isaiah 61, you guys know it's this, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor, send me to bind up the brokenhearted, proclaim freedom to the captives, and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy, which is what we saw an outbreak of in Colorado last week in the midst of all this culture of heaviness and oppression. Joy really broke out there. The oil of joy instead of mourning, garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They'll be called oaks of righteousness, a planting for the Lord for the display of his splendor. Now, this is the part I wanted to get to in verse 4. It says, they will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They will renew the ruined cities that have been devastated for generations. So I want to say this, and please hear my heart. I know it's easy for people in California, in New York, in Michigan, in, I could go through the list of states. It's so easy for us to all bail and go to Texas, all bail and go to Florida. Let's build a bunker, let's hide out, let's get guns, let's do our thing. I get that, and I understand that the climates in those states, go to Idaho, go to Montana, the climates in those states, I understand that. But there's something inherently that we're called to do as believers is rebuild ruined cities, yes. Restore places that have long been devastated. Like, we cannot expect to see a great revival in America. We can't expect to see the political system turned upside down. We cannot expect to see an awakening of hearts by abandoning the darkest cities in the nation.
That's right.
It's just that we cannot do that. And we can't create a theology that allows for that to take place. Now, don't feel bad if you're California, you move to Texas, just don't bring your politics with you. Don't California, they're Texas, or whatever the statement is. But I do feel like it is important for us to have faith and hope and believe for breakthrough in these places.
Yeah.
And so a big theme that we're running with, and I'm going to have Jay talk a little bit because he's starting to go across America and really, really become a spokesperson for Let Us Worship and helping us build up and mobilize for 2022. Because I feel like this is going to be a big year. I feel like for us and the dreams that God has for us, and he spoke to me really clearly, you know, at the end of these 137 cities, he said, we haven't seen anything yet. Like, yeah. What's coming, it's just building and it's growing. But we have to actually believe that God can change cities like Seattle and Detroit and Portland and Chicago and New York and these places where people have fled. And I get it, we get on Twitter and we whine about them and we rag on their governors and how crazy their mayors are. I understand that, but there is inherently a call for us to rebuild and to restore. And this is a big part of why I feel like in 2022, God is calling us to mobilize, to go into the hard cities in America. Yeah. The reality is we could park out in Texas, we could park out in the South, and we would personally love it, right? Because we love the people there. We could camp out there and do Let Us Worship for the next 10 years, and it would be awesome, and thousands of people would come.
Yeah.
And that to us would kind of be the easy button, but that's not how we got here. And we feel like the Lord is calling us in this season to take back those cities, right? A lot of them, guys, have revival history that would blow your mind. The revival history of New York, the revival history of Los Angeles with Azusa Street, the revival history of San Francisco, you know, with the Jesus People movement, revival history. I mean, almost all of these cities have this incredible heritage of revival and breakthrough and signs and wonders and transformation. And so we have to believe that in 2022, God is giving us the keys for these cities.
Yeah, come on. Well, I think, you know, what we did in 2020 and 2021, I mean, that was so historical and God breathed on it. And I mean, if you guys that are watching would have been in our shoes, you know, to show up to a city like four cities a week, spread apart 3 to 4 hours apart, and then have 3 to 10,000 people show up, I mean, you just can't pass those moments. And there was so much that we talked about that we wanted to do in those cities, but we were moving so fast. I mean, you have to kind of follow the wave of God, the glory of God. And so, you know, after building all those relationships, moving in all those cities, We were always talking about what would it be like to really come in and impact, you know, this state, but to go to the head of the snake, like you were talking about before, if we go to Michigan, to go into Detroit and get all of Michigan to join us and anybody else in America, but to go into those places to have an amazing Let Us Worship, but to also connect with the local pastors, really go in and spend time with these guys, put together something that's creative for Detroit, because every city, you know this, Sean, and everybody watching, you know this, every city has its own culture. But like if we go in and let's say before we do the big, huge Let Us Worship event, 2 or 3 days before, we bring missions teams in and we partner with the local ministries and we do evangelism, we feed the homeless. We go down to some of these broken areas and bring Jesus, go to the hardest places. And so, you know, some of the feedback that I've gotten over the over our season was, hey, we would really love to connect with you guys. We would love to dream about, you know, what would it look like to really make a serious impact. And I think it's true. You know, we had to choose what God was doing in this last season. Yeah. What God was doing is showing what he could do, because you know that we didn't do that. Yeah. That was only God that can do that. But now he's given us permission to say, okay, let's pick out some tombs and turn them into wombs.
Come on.
Let's pick out some places of darkness and get all of, so just to say Pennsylvania. Let's get all of Pennsylvania to go into Philadelphia and to spend a few days there, rally, do missions, do ministry, do evangelism, and bring the gospel, and then have an amazing worship service. And then in some of these cities, we go into, and just like the Hold the Line conference we did in Washington, D.C., because a lot of these leaders, they want us to come in and really talk about what it means to be a biblical believer, because we know if we're biblical, it will impact the political world. And so now I think, you know, that with the timing and how God's speaking to us, I think that not only can we go in and have these amazing events, but we can have a window of heaven that opens up over these cities, really get pastors and leaders involved. If you're a pastor or you're a leader and you're watching this, or you're from some of these cities that we're going to be going to represent this state, because if we don't reach these cities, you know this, Sean, those states will be impacted in a political way like never before. And so when you go to Texas, you got to go to Austin. If we don't eventually reach Austin, it's not don't you Cali my Texas, it's don't you Austin my Texas.
Right, yeah. No, I mean, and that's why, you know, we're kicking off the whole year in Miami.
Yeah.
You know, a place that people don't like to go to and people stay away from, and people talk about the darkness of South Beach, and they talk, you know, and when they talk about that, I'm like, man, you ain't seen darkness until you've been with me to, you know, the front lines in Iraq, you know, and you've seen what we've seen, you know, at the height of ISIS. I mean, we understand those dynamics, but we also know that those are the places we're called to go to. And I think what it is in 2022, it represents, you know, the church really got smacked, you know, and assaulted in many ways in 2020 and this year. And it kind of stunned people. Some people rose up, other people were kind of stunned. I feel like 2022 is a year where it's like we are advancing, we're not retreating.
Right.
And that's a big part of what's important is choosing these major cities. So you said Philly and Pennsylvania, you know, Detroit and Michigan, New York City, Chicago and Illinois, you know, these liberal strongholds, places of that are governmental, that rule the state and have influence in the nation, and going into these and gathering the entire state and saying, we are mobilizing, we're going to hijack this city for Jesus.
Yeah.
For a weekend, we're going to go in here, we're going to hit the streets and love on people. We're going to meet people's needs and bring food and clothes and all that kind of stuff. But then we're going to bring the gospel, the kingdom of God. And I just believe that these cities are never going to be the same. And I know that it's just even the Let Us Worship is a one event blowout, but yet it's building a network of leaders that are bold and that are courageous. And I know it's going to continue. And so what I want to do before we end, and this is a big deal because we've never actually released this list.
Right.
I think it's super important for us to share with you the list of the cities that we feel the Lord's calling us to go to. And we don't have the exact dates for some of these. We have the month, around the month of when we feel like we're called to go. But these are the cities that, and the states that the Lord's put on our heart. And so, Jay, why don't you do the honors of reading these out to people?
Okay. Now, listen, if you are a pastor or a leader and you live in these states, okay, We want to connect with you because we want to rally all the people of this state to come together. I believe people are going to come from all over America. But I think if you live in these states, you can help us out, even if you don't live in these actual cities, okay? And so, like Sean said, we are going to go into Florida in December. We're going to go into Miami. But if you live in Florida and you are watching this, or you're a leader or anybody and you want to help us pull off this amazing event in Miami, we're going to have Let Us Worship Florida in Miami. In North Carolina, we're going to go into Charlotte. Last time we were in Charlotte, we almost got arrested in Charlotte.
Yeah, it was crazy.
This is crazy. Billy Graham's home place. This is his hometown, and we're almost getting arrested for the gospel.
And it's a swing state now.
It is, know? Absolutely. So
that's going to be in March.
We're going to go into Louisiana in March as well. California.
And what city is that going to be in?
We're going in Lafayette, which is, it's Lafayette. It's actually, we're pray for us because we're trying to get the Cajun Dome. But no matter what we get, we're still going. Y'all know we don't back down. Okay. So we're going to be in California in April. All right.
And we're probably Southern California.
Southern California. Absolutely. It's going to be amazing. We're going to be in Illinois in June. I'm sorry. We're going to be in Colorado in May. Now in Colorado, we're praying about where to go. Either we're going to go to Denver or
Boulder.
So if you live in that state, please connect with us, okay? We're going to go into
Illinois
in June.
Yes, Chicago. We're going into Chicago in June, the end of June. It's going to be dynamic. The last time we were there, we had over 4,000 people right on Heroin Highway. It was crazy. And so Chicago, I'm super excited about.
If you guys live in Illinois, he always messes with me when I talk because I'd say Illinois. But Illinois, I'm sorry, guys. If you guys live there, you got to come to Chicago. It was the craziest thing. I mean, people running out from the streets, bringing their drugs and throwing them at pastors, getting rid of them, crying on their shoulder. It's going to be awesome, okay? We're going to be in Michigan in July, which we're going to be in the Detroit area. And we're going to be in the Pacific Northwest.
Motown.
Yeah. We're going to rock Motown for Jesus. It's going to be awesome. We're going to be in the Pacific Northwest in August, and we're going to go into Seattle area.
Yeah.
It's going to be off the chain.
We got a lot of history in Seattle, baby. I'm excited. People in Washington, they know how to rumble.
And if you are radical or you want to be radical, you need to come to the Pacific Northwest because that changed my life, okay?
Yeah.
When we did that, that's when I was like, okay, I can't ever turn back. Because you've never seen nothing like the power of God come upon places like Antifa and Satanists. When you see that, bring your teenagers to that. They'll never be the same again. Amen. So we're going to be in Idaho in August in Boise, Idaho. We're going to be in Austin, Texas. We're praying about it either September or October. We're still praying about the right time.
Austin's going to be rowdy because we want Dallas, Houston, Corpus, San Antonio, Lubbock, Midland, Tyler, all the cities we've gone to across Texas. We want to convene in the capital city. I know that people say, you know, Austin's weird. Yeah, that's great. It's weird, but it's the governmental epicenter, and it's time to shift the narrative over that city. So we need you to be there, Texas.
Yeah, and you got to know, people from California are moving to Austin. That's where they're going. So we need to go and rumble over there. You got all these tech guys moving to Austin, okay? So also, we're going to be in Pennsylvania in September in Philadelphia. And right now we're working on the mall. Like, we pretty much have the mall.
It's the Liberty Bell.
The
area where the Liberty Bell is, right downtown. It's historic. It's epic. It's the best place in the whole state to work.
It's going to be crazy. And we're going to be in New York City in October. It's going to be awesome. Listen to me. You got it. We need to go back and this is the best time ever to rebuild New York. I'm just telling you, man, New York is in ruins right now. We need people to go. And also, you know, we will always end with a bang, and the place is just the highlight of what we do, which is
Washington, D.C.
We'll
be there back in October next year. We are working right now on a special event that's going to be leading up to the Let Us Worship in Washington, D.C. in October. It's going to be historic. Like Jay mentioned, we're going to be holding several hold-the-line intensives. We're going to do these, not in every city we mentioned, but in several of them. We're going to do hold-the-line intensives, which I feel like is just going to add another dimension to this. Yeah. You know, we're going to gather people together, gather the political leaders, the ones that love the Lord, and we are going to let them begin to share to us, how do we shift these states, right? How do we shift? 2022 is a big year. November 2022, the midterms, guys. This is huge for the control of Senate, Congress. I mean, you got governmental, governor races across America. So this is really, I believe that things are going to dramatically shift in 2022. I had the privilege of talking to President Trump about this, actually sharing my heart. He asked, you know, what I thought, because I mean, think he knows we've been across America more than anyone. And I do have a sense of expectation. It's going to be a fight, but I believe that we're going to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. And so here's the takeaway. 2022 is going to be wild. It starts on New Year's Eve in Miami, Florida. You do not want to miss it. Jay is going to be traveling across America from now until then, mobilizing in these cities. I'll be in some of them as well. We will have some other events that are scattered out throughout the year, but in terms of Let Us Worship, our main gathering points, we just gave them to you. There's 12 of them in 2022. It's significant. 12 is the number of government. That's the number that the Lord gave us. Those are the regions he told us to go to. And so we're really excited. Please do us a favor. Go to letusworship.us. Sign up for our newsletter where you're going to get all this information even before we post it on social media. Make sure that you look out for my man, Jay. He's crazy, and he's coming to a city near you to mobilize. We need pastors. We need leaders. I don't know another ministry, and there's amazing ministries across America, but we are going full-blown revival or bust in this season. Yeah. So why don't you do this? Why don't you end with praying everybody off, just the excitement and anticipation that we have for what God's doing. Let Us Worship with Hold the Line in 2022.
Let me say one thing. Listen, if you're a pastor, and I've said this before, or a leader, there's going to be enough ministry in these 3 or 4 days that we're in these cities that we need all hands on deck. We're calling every leader to come together. So like Sean said, please email us if you want to help us, or you represent your church and you want us to come. Even if it's me when I come to these cities having coffee with you, you know, whatever we can do to mobilize, we really need your help, because it's going to be all hands on deck to change these cities. But let me pray for you right now. Father, I just thank you so much for what you've done, not just in 2020, but in 2021. But Lord, we thank you that when we step into this new season in 2022, that we're going to see things like Sean said, the word of the Lord for this season is that you have not seen anything yet. I pray that we can come together for such a time as this. I pray that every person that are a part of these states and these cities, God, that come to join us, Lord, that we will see not only you transform our hearts, but you will transform the minds, and you will take these cities, you will take these states, and you will take those tombs, and you will turn them into wombs that birth some of the most beautiful things that only you could do. I pray for an impartation of boldness, soul winning, unity, healing. I pray for the fire of God to fall on every person watching this. And I thank you, Lord, that when we come together, there's nothing that will ever hold the church back when we come together. And now is the time like never before in all these states. Bless these leaders, bless these people in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come on, let's go for it. Let's change the nation in 2022. Yeah. Let's follow the voice of the Lord and let's be bold. Let's hold the line. We'll see you soon.
Yeah.